Before we get into detail into John chapter 8, there is one thing we have to go over. We cannot attain biblical knowledge from Hollywood. We cannot trust what Hollywood does. We cannot trust any interpretation that Hollywood makes about the Bible for four main reasons. Number one, they are never accurate. No Hollywood depiction of the adultering woman has ever been historically accurate. In other words, they have sometimes twisted the story to suit their own political and ideological needs. Number two, they use modern translations like the NIV, and I'm going to prove to you later on, through the use of the Geneva Bible and the 1611 King James, why the NIV is a heretical book. Number three, they have no morals or values. Hollywood is driven by money. That is their chief thing. That is what they strive for. Morals and values have gone out the window in Hollywood, and I don't have to explain any of that. I think you can see that for yourself. And number four, they hate Christ. Hollywood is wicked. It's evil. It's run by evil people. And they hate Christ. That's pretty obvious. So anything they can do to throw into the story of Jesus Christ to, you know, confuse Christians, to confound people, and to change the truth of God to suit their needs, they will do. This is why no pastor should trust them, no Christian teacher should trust them, and no Christian should trust anything Hollywood does to teach them anything about the Bible. You want to learn anything about God's Word, you go straight to God's Word. Okay, to begin my piece-by-piece examination of John chapter 8, the adultering woman, we begin with verse 1 and 2. Jesus went unto Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. Now, I'm going to use my crude map, and I'm going to explain all this, and I'm going to give you a reasonable idea why I think there was a certain place that Jesus sat to teach the people that were going to come and listen to him speak that morning before the adultering woman was brought to him. Okay, we begin John chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, and here's my wonderfully splendid drawing. Okay, Mount Olives. Jesus Christ begins here in the morning. Now, the most direct route to the temple complex itself is along this road. This road goes over the Kidron Valley between Mount of Olives and the Temple Mount. And there is a gate. There is a three-opening gate called the Golden Gate. This is the most direct route in, and I believe this is the route that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ took as he went into the temple that morning. This gate, the Golden Gate, is bricked up. It was bricked up, and a cemetery was put in front of it by Suleiman the Great. When he took Jerusalem, when he heard about the Hebrew stories of the Messiah, he blocked this gate and he put this cemetery in front of it because he wanted to prevent the Savior from going through the gate. And I don't know how that's going to stop Jesus Christ. It's pretty funny if you think about it. Up here is the fortress of Antonia. This fortress usually garrisoned an entire Roman legion. It also doubled as a prison. You've probably seen that if you were watching the 1960 movie Ben-Hur. Now, around the Temple Mount, there were Roman Greek-style porticos. Okay, and these porticos had steps that went from the palisades or the columns down into the general court. This general court here is where both men and women, Gentile and Jew, could flock. This was also where rabbis, learned teachers, scribes, Pharisees, and rabbinical students could sit and debate the scriptures. They could hold classes. And this is important to understand because there were places to sit all the way around the general court. And I'm going to explain to you later why it was not a good idea for you to be sitting on the court floor itself. Now, these porticos, of course, went all the way around the Temple Mount, and they attached to what is known as the Royal Stoa, or what is known as the Great Pinnacle. It is believed from this pinnacle, from this complex here, that Satan tempted Jesus Christ to leap off the pinnacle and be saved by angels, as it states in Psalms 91. Of course, Jesus rebuked him for that. Now, Here is the temple complex itself. Okay. This outer ring here, this blue ring, is known as the court of the Gentiles. Okay. This one right here, this little block, is the woman's court. Women could proceed no farther into the temple complex. This is where they had to give their sacrifices and their atonements to the priest who would then perform the sacrifices. Now, between the court of the Gentiles and the temple complex itself, this is Herod's temple, by the way, there was a 4-foot stone wall, which was a screening wall, which kept separate clean Jews from unclean Jews and unclean people, Gentiles, which at the time, of course, Jews saw all Gentiles as being unclean, barbarian animals. Then we get into the temple complex itself. And Herod's temple was said to be beautiful to the eyes. It was incredible. This entire complex itself was redone by King Herod. Now, was it to glorify God? No. Well, it was to glorify Herod, because Herod was a massive megalomaniac. Now, this whole temple floor itself, the general court, the temple floor, but this whole temple complex, the Temple Mount, was covered in polished granite stone. This is going to become very important when we start talking about Jesus Christ, the dust, and our Lord and Savior writing in the dust. So this is what happened in verses 1 and 2. Once again, Jesus Christ awakes in the morning on the Mount of Olivet. He travels along this road to the Golden Gate, which is now shut, bricked up with a cemetery in the front, because Suleiman the Great believed that he could stop Messiah from going through this gate when he comes again on top of Mount Olivet. Jesus Christ proceeded into the general court. Now this is where I believe the event with the adultering woman took place. Because number one, it is a massive, massive area. You could have the multitudes that are spoken of, multitude being great masses, and you also had places in the portico areas, and you also had places out here where one could sit and not sit directly on the Temple Mount itself. So we will next get into verses 3 and 4. Okay, once again, a quick review of verse 2 of John chapter 8. Jesus Christ has entered the Temple Mount via the Golden Gate from the Mount of Olives through the Kidron Valley. He has entered here. There are the porticos, which go all the way around, and they attach to the Great Stoa, which is the pinnacle, believed to be where Satan tempted Christ to leap off the pinnacle in Matthew. You will notice the temple complex here. This is the general court. From the porticos, there are stairs leading down into the general court. I believe this is the place right here where Jesus Christ did his teaching when the adultering woman was brought to him. The reason why is the Bible says he taught people. It did not specify he was teaching men or women at the time. So the general court was where both men and women would congregate. These steps would have provided places to sit. Also, around the temple floor itself, there were blocks, there were seats, there were other ways to sit. Now, you would not sit directly on the Temple Mount itself without something beneath you, between you and the stone. Hebrew custom tells us that sitting here would not be a good idea unless you were sitting in a seat or you were sitting with something underneath you. Also, most Hollywood depictions of the adultering woman show dirt. They show a lot of dirt and sand on the ground, and this is where Jesus is doing his writing. He's not even writing in these movies. He's actually just doodling and tracing his finger, which is wrong. The Temple Mount complex is has a floor of hewn stone. Hewn and elaborate stonework. Remember, this is King Herod's temple, and Herod, being a megalomaniac that he was, spared no expense on this whole temple complex. It was beautiful to behold. So it was kept constantly clean. There was, of course, blowing dust because of sandstorms and so forth. But the temple complex was beautiful to behold. It was a marvelous thing to see. So it was not covered in dirt. Dirt did not cover the entire floor of the Temple Mount. And I believe this is where Jesus was doing his teaching to the multitudes before him, before the Pharisees and the scribes brought the adultering woman to him. All right, allow me to read verses 3 through 3 to 5 from John chapter 8. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now, Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? Okay, a quick review of John chapter 8, verses 3 to 5. Jesus is sitting. He's probably sitting in the general court where most of the teachings were being done. He is probably sitting either on the steps that lead from the portico down into the general court, or he is sitting somewhere on a bench, or he's sitting on a stone block. He's not sitting on the actual floor of the temple itself. The scribes and the Pharisees bring the woman, placing her in the midst, placing her before Jesus Christ. So now we have Jesus Christ sitting down, the woman before him, the scribes and the Pharisees after the woman, and then the great multitude of people who have come to hear Jesus teach. So that would be people on his left, people on his right, and people out into the general court. She has been accused of adultery, specifically Leviticus 20 and verse 10, and I will read that here in a little bit. In accordance with the law of Moses, as the scribes and Pharisees have said, she must be put to death by stoning. But then they asked Jesus Christ, what sayest thou? Now remember an important point in verses 3 to 5. They referred to him as master. So they honored him as an understanding man of the law. But of course, when we get to verse 6, this is going to explain their true motive. Okay, so now I'm going to read Leviticus 20 and verse 10. This is the charge that they made against the woman. And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. So, it would appear the woman's guilt was clear enough. Number one, she was caught in the act, in progress, of committing adultery, which means she was a married woman. There were witnesses, more than two. As it says in the Bible, on the witness of two or more, let the matter be firmly established. The case is clear. She has committed adultery, and by the law of Moses, she should be stoned to death. However, in the next part, we're going to get into verse 6, which begins to unravel the case that these guys are trying to make. And it proves that they had committed multiple violations of laws in order to arrest justice from the woman in an attempt to trap Jesus Christ.